Andy and Dave Daly right here on the Muskegon Channel. I'm Andy O'Reilly. There's Dave Cackley back after a couple of days off. Dave had to get reacquainted with his mod box set, which, you know, good for him.
Yeah, okay. Mod, really? Well, you know,
you're a B. Arthur fan.
Golden Girls B. Arthur, not Maude B. Arthur. Maude B. Arthur was a little off-putting. I shouldn't even say that because I don't think I ever saw an entire episode of Maude because I did not like her in that role. I like her as Dorothy on Golden Girls, even though she's kind of got a bit of the acidic tongue there, but I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't off-put for whatever reason. It worked well with the other ladies, even though I guess she hated Betty White.
What a bitch. How do you hate Eddie White? Or Betty White?
Yeah, B. Arthur did not like Betty White. Well, that's the scuttlebutt.
Well, then guess what? I don't like B. Arthur then.
Okay, there you go.
But I'm going to give you a TV tip.
Go ahead.
You know who Joanna Lumley is?
I don't think so.
Sweetie Dolly, Sweetie Dolly, Sweetie Dolly. Absolutely fabulous.
I never watched. I know. I remember
she's
when
the tall
fabulous
blonde
was on.
That was on. Okay. Absolutely fabulous.
I never
right?
saw a single episode of that, but I was aware of her. Yet.
I watched bits and pieces of it. I was never a really big fan. A little weird, you know, British humor.
Yeah.
So, you know, whatever.
Yeah, it's.
But I'm going to tell you what.
If it's not Monty Python,
I didn't even get that.
Really?
Benny Hill was funny to me when I was 12.
See, but, my dad loved Benny Hill. I hated Benny Hill.
Right.
But I loved Monty Python when I was a kid.
Anyway.
And still do.
Joanna Lumley was an actress. She was a model. She was just a multimedia talent going all the way back to the early 70s in Britain. Okay. And now she's basically doing her retirement gig where she tours the world and shows you. Like, it's like a travelog show. Of places that Americans aren't even allowed to go film. The other day, we watched a show on her looking for the Ark on top of Mount Ararat in the middle of, you know, that part of the world where we can't even take a camera crew anymore. So to see the geography and the beauty and the idea of people who might be Islamic or Muslim who sit there. I mean, this guy's like, she goes, do you think they'll ever find the Ark? And the guy's like, well, you know, if it's God's will to find the ark, we'll find the ark. Other than that, I don't know.
Yeah.
And you know what it's like to see another culture that's just normal people? Mm-hmm. Because what gets me is that when we go to those other parts of the world, let's say you go to India, let's say you go to the Middle East, let's say you go to, what do we generally see?
We see the worst of it.
You see the toilets. Yeah.
There's
it's
the
like,
reason, yeah. Yeah, and there's a reason for it.
Give me something else to look at once in a while, and let's balance this thing out a little bit.
Yeah, because it's never what is perceived. Like,
yeah,
the whole perception is reality thing. I never bought that.
They do the same thing to us. I mean, they show Americans in the worst light in a lot of these things too. Don't get me wrong.
We do that to ourselves here too.
Yeah,
we show the worst of the worst because
it sells.
It leads. It sells 100%. And it isn't, and I've always pushed back against that because perception isn't always reality.
Right.
What you feel right now about something isn't necessarily valid. You may have false feelings. Like I've had false feelings about things. I've had irrational fears. I've had, and I still do.
Yep.
And that's one of those things where if you don't understand that, you know, a lot of what you, not a lot, but some of what you experience are outliers. There are things that aren't, okay, this isn't, or they're not accurate, or I feel something is this way. Well, maybe you're right, maybe you're not.
Right.
So
anyway,
like, people get kind of wrapped
she
up.
She is amazing on this travelog show, and she is so good at appreciation and standing there and just going, look at that.
Yeah.
And you're sitting there watching your TV going, wow, look at that. It's fantastic. It's really
very cool.
The shift in programming, I think, is refreshing compared to what we're used to. Because, how do I want to put this? You know, the branding around our programming is designed to defeat us. You know, like there's the History Channel model. There's the Travel Channel model. There's, right. And it all seems kind of cookie cutter. That premium choice format. Mm-hmm. Yeah, premium choice, right. But to just watch how other companies do things, it's a refreshing mm-hmm. change. And I'll tell you what, for $3.99 a month, probably the best thing I buy on Amazon. Seriously, it's great. So invest, my friend. Expand your horizons. Do that.
I've got to expand. I got so much. I got so much stuff. Like but I find myself doing this. I don't know if you're guilty of this either. I find there are all these things. I'll be flipping through things, and go like, man, I want to see that, but I don't want to see that right now. Nope. And I'll go back to old stuff that like it's like comfort. Even if it's a documentary that I know I like, I'll like go back and I'll watch that over and over again.
Yep.
Like do these deep dives on either whether it's a Kennedy assassination or Hitler. I like go back and forth on all this stuff going, okay, what happened? How did this happen here? Okay. And here's a different view of it. And because I know I'm interested in the subject matter.
Right.
And I like to have that. And it's like, and something about the narration of those things too.
Gets good at narration.
Yeah. See, that to me is big. And nothing can ruin a documentary quicker than we've had the AI narration that doesn't.
Bad.
That was horrible.
Horrible.
There was one. The worst was it was on Tom Hanks. I couldn't get 4 minutes in. Mm. Like, this is the worst thing ever. And I mean, Tom Hanks is interesting, but I can't watch this because I can't stand the voice. There's no feeling because there's certain narrators that give you that can set a mood and set a tone and give you a particular feeling.
Right.
And it's not necessarily positively or negatively about the subject matter. It's just it's just a vibe. It's just a different.
Let me show you how that works.
Okay, good.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present the one and only Dave Cackley with today's news. Could you feel that?
I did.
Gave you that feeling you were climbing a rope in gym class, didn't it?
Oh, okay. That's not that far, but anyway. Foreign terrorists targeting the U.S. is, quote, increasingly concerning. This according to the FBI director. Christopher Wray says ISIS and Al-Qaeda have renewed calls for attacks against Jewish communities in the West. According to Wray, adversaries and terrorist groups are targeting cyber operations, security, and using mafia-like tactics. So apparently at some point, somebody's going to wind up next to a severed horse's head. That's what I'm taking that to mean. I hear this stuff, and I know it's real. I know it's a serious threat, but I am, and this is just a product of age, and you realize like, okay, there's certain things I have zero control over, so I really don't worry about them. Like I have zero concerns really about that, even though it's a concerning thing, but I can't do anything about it. I don't worry. I mean, it's like I tell Max, just keep your head on a swivel.
Right.
You just be aware of your surroundings. That's it. And then we move on because because you can just overwhelm yourself with worry about any number of things and it just isn't worth it.
To me, it's just got to get down to the deeper issues. You know, why do we fight over religion? Why do we fight over societal position? Why do we fight over, what is it that gets into the mind of humans? The other day I saw somebody shared an old confession chair from the Crusades.
Hmm.
It was what they stuck women in to get them to confess for being a witch or somebody to confess for blasphemy or anything like this.
Mm-hmm.
What gets into the mind of humans and who has got balls enough to put those ideas in the heads of people that it's a good thing to turn spirituality and religion into a war? When that stops, when that idea that my God is better than your God comes to a screeching halt, we're going to see a dramatic shift in the way the world works.
That's one of those things that, you would see a dramatic shift. You would. But, and again, it goes back to philosophies and religions evolve. And there mm-hmm. are some sects of some religions that have not evolved to that point yet. And that's why we're at that point.
Yep.
In certain areas, again, it's
it doesn't take
a lot of people.
It doesn't take
a lot of people to do it.
To create
that fear and to create that anxiety and to create that conflict. But it's older than, I mean, you're talking thousands.
It truly
these
is.
These are thousands of year conflicts.
And in thousands of years, why have we not evolved enough to stop and say,
right,
hey, maybe we should look at this a different way?
Well, some people look, I mean, individuals will, collectively we don't.
Because
we're all a bunch of individuals. And
I'm standing here asking tough questions, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's like, for a species that is the top of the food chain, supposedly, and apparently the biggest thinkers on the planet, we ought to be thinking better.
I think sometimes when we think about the biggest thinkers, they don't think about stuff like this. They think about the tangible stuff. They do. That's just the smart, the allegedly smartest people. I'm talking about from a human intellectual standpoint.
Right.
They're thinking about the tan. They're thinking about like things like going to Mars or creating the thing that cleans up the environment, or how do we make this transition where a lot of these people are going to be losing their jobs. They have the AI. You got, and these are reasonable things to be concerned about and reasonable things to try and figure out, like, and for the survival of the species or whatever, because the idea that we're eventually going to have to leave here.
Yep.
Now, I don't have any thoughts about that. I don't care.
Yep.
I honestly don't care about going to Mars. A lot of other people do, but I don't. That's just my belief is I don't care. That's,
you don't like going to Kalamazoo. So
I don't like going to Kalamazoo. I know, I'll go, because, you jump on 131. It's not as long as of a trek as you think from Barry County. So I'll make that trek on occasion. But, yeah, I just,
Oy vey, what's next?
Gen Z continues to wallow in perpetual sadness. This, according to the latest survey, 75% of 12 to 26-year-olds unhappy. And a lot of factors, a couple specifically, lack of sleep and relaxation apparently are major problems for the young people. However, here's some good news. The sadness appears to lessen as Gen Zers get a little older, you get into adulthood, and that's just the way it is. I think it's harder now. It's always hard going through adolescence, but it's harder now. And I mean, I'm dealing with a teenager, a 14-year-old, who's had it probably easier than most because he hasn't gone through like awkward stages. He's got his own problems, but I've been blessed with the normal teenage stuff. It's girls. It's, it's okay, dude.
It's girls.
You gotta work a little harder in school.
I love listening to him at the event a couple weeks ago.
Oh, jeez.
I got these sophomores hitting on me, and I'm like, yeah, dude.
don't encourage that. I'm trying to not be a grandfather before the kid graduates high school.
I'm married to a cougar. You think I'm not going to encourage that?
Yeah. Yes. I don't encourage it.
Catch the gravy train and get running. That's what I'm telling them.
That's not a gravy train.
Don't trust your dad. Listen to your Uncle Andy. You're on the right path, kid.
I'll give him some credit.
Go after the seniors.
Dude, that is what concerns me going into high school next year, because the opportunities I don't even want to think about. I don't even want to think about. So it's,
I got, I'm your wingman. Like, I got him.
Focus. No.
But Andy O'Reilly, life coach.
You're gonna get a call. You're gonna go, hey Andy, you and Cindy gonna be out of town. Can I use the cottage? No, he can't.
Yeah.
No, he can't.
Yeah.
And it'd be none of that.
Max, you're gonna leave towels for the hot tub too.
Stop. What the hell is wrong with you?
Well, he's got to dry off. I don't want him sitting on the furniture wet.
Oh my God. Anyway, so yeah, he's pretty good. It's one of those things you gotta. It's too
word
much now.
Word must be he's getting around. Still... He's pretty good if they're chasing after him from high school.
No, stop.
I'm sorry. Did I say that out loud?
He's a good kid.
Yeah.
He's just got a I don't know. I can't even give him advice. I just like, I don't know. I don't even know what to tell the kid. I really don't. It's like, don't do anything stupid.
Okay.
Just don't do anything stupid, okay. Which is hard to tell a teenager because they're going to do things that are stupid. But hopefully just nothing life-changing. Finally, City of Muskegon looking for community input on how to best express the city's identity, city officials, and its marketing agency, its contractual marketing agency,
ooh,
are encouraging citizens to fill out a survey posted online and in the city's newsletter. The rebranding effort was launched last year through a $50,000 contract with Kindred Marketing. You 50 are,
grand.
You know, you know the ins and outs of Ski Town. What say you on this? What would be your plan? What's the best way to express the identity of Muskegon?
Hmm. All right, I got it.
Good.
Welcome to Muskegon, home of Charles Hackley, home of Andy O'Reilly. Done.
Wow.
Yeah.
They'll be driving in from Drow. They'll be driving in from as far away as.
I'll do special things. We'll do as 50 grand. You mean you throw that kind of dough out there? I'm gonna start looking at my piece of the pie.
Okay. So there you go.
And I know the guy, so it's like the pressure's starting to mount. We can do autograph days. We can do get your picture with Andy days. We can do Andy comes to your bar mitzvah day. We can do any of that stuff. I'm open. Open to work, as they say on LinkedIn.
There you go. Open to work, as they say on LinkedIn. For those of you who are still on LinkedIn. Sports, Tigers were off. Cubs lose. They fall to San Diego, 10-2. The Wings are off. Pistons still suck. That's sports.
Famous Families is for 400 today in our Jeopardy category. And this one could be difficult. It goes like this. In this family, Henry was a historian. His grandfather and his great-grandfather both had been U.S. presidents. 400 today. You skipped over a couple of tough ones with your 2-day off.
I believe that would be Adams.
Son of a bitch. You got it.
John and John Quincy.
Look at you.
What happens when you watch John Adams on HBO?
Oh.
Starring.
The one and only Pig Vomit. Yeah. Nice.
Pig Vomit and Laura Linney. As Abigail Adams.
Wasn't that a fantastic role? Good for her.
It was.
Dave, have yourself a great Thursday or whatever the hell it is, and we'll see you back here tomorrow.
See ya!
Happy Thursday, Muskegon. Heavy rain will move into the region today, so let's take a look at your forecast brought to you by Trinity Health. Like I said, heavy rain will move in as early as Thursday morning, right around 6, 7, 8 a.m. or so, and that will continue pretty much all day, so it will be a pretty cool day with lots of low clouds as well. But thankfully, by the weekend, things will definitely get a lot better out there. This is the future radar. By 8 a.m., you can see widespread rainfall, at least light rain, is expected to move into West Michigan. But as the day goes on, that rain will pick up in intensity. By the early afternoon hours, widespread rain is expected all across West Michigan, especially from I-94 and points to the north, as the low pressure system moves off to the east. And then by 8 p.m., wraparound rain will continue. And then going into Friday, some of that may actually be like enhanced since it will be so chilly. This is what one of the models is forecasting for the amount of rain that is expected. Muskegon will probably get at least an inch, if not maybe an inch and a half of rain. And the heaviest rain will stay to the east toward Lansing, where they could get up to 3 inches of rain, which is quite a bit in one system. So for your Thursday, expect a high of only 52 degrees. Will be cooler thanks to the low clouds and also the rain. And it will be also pretty breezy today with gusts up to 30 miles per hour during the day and then up to 40 miles per hour Thursday night with a low of 44. Then on Friday, the rain will probably end midday or so, but will stay cloudy for the rest of the day with temperatures only in the low 50s Over the weekend, though, with some sunshine, we'll warm up into the mid-50s and then the mid-60s on Sunday, and we'll stay in the 60s probably early next week, along with a chance of thunderstorms by Tuesday. And that's your Thursday forecast brought to you by Trinity Health on the Muskegon Channel. And I'm Cold Weather, and enjoy your day.